Let the meltdown begin. MMA Meltdown. Let's do this thing. I am Gabriel Morency. We've got a great program lined up for you tonight. It's UFC Fight Night 33 this Friday night from Brisbane, Australia. We're going to break it down with Reed Kuhn, Fightnomics.com, SureDog.com. Robin Black from the Fight Network will join me in studio. Joey Odessa crunches the numbers from Costa Rica. We got some great videos of the week this week, including a video of last week's guest, Marina Shafir, who just won the Tough Enough Championship. And you know what? I'm in a good mood tonight because normally these fight nights are on Wednesday night and we can't talk about it because the show airs on Wednesday night. So tonight we're all things Fight Night 33 and we will be watching these fights live at Trophy Sports Bar in Montreal. We're going to have some of the TriStar guys coming down and hanging out. So come down, say hi. We'll be at Trophy Sports Bar this Friday night watching the fights and we're going to break down all the fights right here tonight. MMA Meltdown, all that and more on the Fight Network. MMA Meltdown on the Fight Network continues. I am Gabriel Morency. We're in a unique situation this week. Oftentimes, since we air on Wednesday and Thursdays, we're unable to break down the fight nights because they're so often on Wednesday nights. But because they're in Brisbane, Australia, Saturday there, Friday night here, and of course, we're going to be broadcasting live from Trophy Sports Bar in Montreal watching the fights. And this should be a fun fight card coming off the Ultimate Fighter finale, in which that's 5 hours of our lives that none of us will be getting back anytime soon. We're going to break down this card in its entirety here this evening, and let's bring in our first guest of the program from Fightnomics.com. You've seen him on SureDog.com, and he's been working on a book that I can't wait to get my hands on, and it's going to be released very, very soon. Mr. Reed Kuhn joins us. Reed, it's always a pleasure. How you doing?
I'm doing great. Thanks a lot for having me.
No, we always enjoy breaking down the fights with you. So you've been working on this book for a while now, and I know it's very tedious. You're a very meticulous person. You're a numbers-driven guy, so it's taken a little while, but sounds like it's nearly ready to go.
Yeah, it's ready to go. It's kind of been in the hopper now for over a month, and we're just waiting for it to roll off the presses, and that's actually happening right now. It should be in the print as we speak. So we're going to have the digital version up by next week, probably by next Wednesday. And then the print version should be up on Amazon by the 20th. And so one way or the other, I hope to have it out soon enough this month. And I'm excited just to share it with everybody because there's a lot of things I've been talking about that I can't explain in a sentence or a tweet. It just takes a chapter to explain it.
Well, you know, and I appreciate your cheat sheets, and they're great stuff. Reed's the best in the business when it comes to the analytics of mixed martial arts by far. But as far as the book is concerned, is it editorial? Is it numbers? Like, what is in the book?
Yeah, I try to attack a lot of the big questions. You know, I look at macro trends, the history of the UFC. How do fights end? Are there more knockouts than submissions? How has that changed over time? And then I isolate individual variables. How does striking work? You know, how often does a punch land on the head versus the body versus a leg kick? How often do knockouts occur? What kinds of knockouts are there? What are the differences between being in the clinch and on the ground and standing at a distance? All of these things in MMA that make it a very complicated sport, I think the casual fan has been missing out on some of the nuance of it. So hopefully by explaining it in detail, lots of graphs, numbers really tell the story of how fights go down. And some of the big trends, you know, the advantages. What does it mean to be older, younger, longer, or taller, or be a southpaw versus orthodox? All these things that we talk about in sports, we take it for granted that maybe there's some advantages inherent in there. And so I finally quantified all of them, and I've stacked them all up together. You can see which advantages are more important than others. What are the disadvantages? So hopefully this book answers a lot of questions.
Yeah, it sounds like a real guide for the gamer as well out there, a guy that's laying it down on the fights. And as you mentioned, stuff evolves, right? So when you look at the history of the UFC and you're breaking it down from an analytical standpoint, it must be interesting to see the trends change. You know, maybe something that was effective before isn't quite as effective now. And I remember you and I talking about this maybe about a year ago or so. And, you know, you had the breakdown of knockouts per weight class. And, you know, the lower weight classes had less finishes in the fights. Yet, we've seen, it's amazing. I don't know if it's the alpha male guys basically on their own that destroyed that trend of analytics, but just a ton of knockouts in the 135 and 145 weight class that we weren't seeing before, Reed. It's amazing. It's like if you bet on football, you know, it's a more offensive sport right now, the National Football League, and scoring is up. Therefore, the totals go up. And, you know, you see the same thing. If you follow this stuff long enough and you're betting on this stuff long enough, you notice trends do evolve and change.
That's true. And actually, one reason for that is that fighters are staying standing more often. They're attempting fewer takedowns, and stand-ups are occurring on the ground more quickly because I think the crowd wants to see a standing striking matchup. So the overall amount of time that's being spent on the mat has gone down and down and down. And even in the clinch, guys aren't staying in the clinch as long. So they're standing and trading at a distance. And that's one of the reasons why you're seeing more knockouts.
You know, that's interesting. And it's funny because before the Gray Maynard fight against Diaz on Saturday night, I had a lot of people, and I did pick Maynard, but a lot of people were saying, you know, Maynard's got to go back to his wrestling and he's got to take him down and all that other stuff. And I tweeted before the fight, I said, who does that anymore? Like, everyone's a wrestler in college. Nobody ever really tries to take anybody down. There's the exceptions. You know, Kane will mix it up extremely well. But you know, I've noticed, you know, we see guys, it doesn't matter. Hell, Johnny Hendricks, you know, champion wrestler, he doesn't really try takedowns that often anymore.
Yeah, that's true. It's an interesting trend. I mean, these guys did very well for a while. But I think they've been stalling out on the ground lately. And when they do get down there, getting stood up almost looks bad for the guy on top. Like, he stalled out. He wasn't able to do anything. And it's almost shame on you for getting down there and then not doing anything with it. And so the fact that referees are standing fighters up more quickly than ever before, it might be hurting them.
Well, as far as takedowns are concerned, Mark Hunt and Bigfoot, you expecting many takedowns in this fight, Reed?
Well, I'm not, and that would be a mistake for Silva because, you know, he does have a black belt in jiu-jitsu, and Mark Hunt's, you know, most of his losses are by submission. So I think it would be a mistake for Silva to stand and trade with Hunt. But Silva, that hasn't stopped him before trying to stand and trade with guys who are dangerous strikers. I think that will be a mistake. I think Mark Hunt is going to find the chin despite the eight-inch reach differential between the two of them. I think it's only a matter of time before Hunt finds that mark. And he's trying to improve his ground game. And we saw him rolling around quite a bit with Stefan Struve, who's an extremely dangerous submission artist. And he was able to survive long enough to eventually, you know, do what he does, which is weather that storm and find the chin late. He's only going to need one or two clean shots on Silva before he drops him. And I think that's how this is going to end. Quite frankly, I'm surprised that Mark Hunt is currently considered an underdog. He should be considered a very lively underdog.
Yeah, and it's coming down right now. The money is coming in on Mark Hunt, and as we expect it to as well. And, you know, as you stated, you got to believe that Silva's ego will get the best of him, and he will stand and trade with Mark Hunt. And I don't see how that ends well for him. Mark Hunt's chin is a hell of a lot stronger than Alistair Overeem's is, with all due respect to Overeem.
Absolutely. And, you know, Silva's takedown offense isn't all that good. He has attempted takedowns before. He doesn't really land them very often. And Mark Hunt has an 81% takedown defense, which is very good. So surprisingly, I think he knows that he's susceptible on the ground, and he's worked on keeping people at bay and being evasive. So I think the numbers are favorably aligned for Hunt here.
I like Mark Hunt, and I'll be taking a look at the under in this fight as well. I haven't seen the odds for the totals, but I'm assuming that this will be a 1.5. They're not going to make it 2.5. So even at 1.5, 7 minutes is it's a long time. And you know, Mark Hunt with those heavy-ass hands, it's going to be a fun fight to watch. Just as this next fight's very interesting with Shogun. This fight's basically a pick'em here against Ahuna. And, you know, Shogun's kind of older for his years due to all the wars that he has been in. And, you know, we saw Shogun lose and get taken down. Shogun generally wants to stand in the pocket and just, you know, put on a show. And he's confident enough in his chin that he's going to get you. But Shogun, you know, this seems to me like a fight where Shogun would be better off trying to take the Ahuna down. But I don't think he's going to do it.
Yeah, it's tough to know. I do think that Hua is the more dangerous guy. Amazingly, he's also 2 months younger than Tohunga. It's amazing to think that Shogun Hua, as much as he has done in his career, he's won a UFC title, he's been around a long time, he's actually the younger fighter here, which is amazing to me. And I think his experience and the quality of opponents that he has faced is the difference here. When I line up the stats line, it's kind of back and forth. It's somewhat even. One guy has an advantage here, but then it's flipped on the other side. So I go down the line, and it's a fairly even matchup, and I think to myself, okay, that makes sense. It's nearly a pick 'em fight. And Hua is technically currently an underdog, ever so slightly. But I have to think that the strength of schedule here has got to favor Hua. He's been in deep waters before. He's been against very dangerous opponents before. And James Tohunga was a guy I was big on. He had some crazy stats coming out of the gate. But as he's progressed, I don't think he's really lived up to the potential, at least the expectations that I had for him early on. And so I think he is susceptible here. I do say that this is probably the closest matchup of kind of the big ones, the marquee matchups on the card. Either way, I think it's a very exciting fight. If Hua gets back on track, that's interesting for its own reasons. If Tohunga wins, that is a monster upset, I think, just conceptually, even though the line doesn't say it.
No, it is. You're right. It'd be, and you know, it would be a huge feather in his cap. Any fighter would be very proud to say, you know what, I fought Shogun and I beat him, but I don't think he's going to beat him. I like Shogun in this fight as well, and for the similar reasons that you do. You know, Shogun's seen it all. He's been in wars, and Tohunga's not going to be able to overmatch him on the ground. Shogun can hold his own with anybody standing up. I think Shogun gets it done in this fight.
I agree.
All right, Reed, into Ryan Bader. Speaking of, not really living up to expectations or... You know, Ryan Bader's one of these guys, physically fit. And I had Aaron Simpson on, who trains with him last week on MMA Meltdown Radio. They talked about it being a great camp and, he's in great shape. And I couldn't help but, say, listen, Aaron, like, you guys are always in great shape at that camp. Like, that's not the issue. Bader's always in great shape. We know he's going to run the miles. We know he's going to hit the weights. We know he's going to put the hours in the gym. But, something changes inside the octagon. For me, this is a must-win fight for Ryan Bader. I don't think he gets, released if he loses the fight. But, from where he's at in his career right now, and there's no shame. I mean, it's not as, people might be a little bit too hard on Bader. I find Bader an interesting case in study. Like, are people too hard on him? If you look, aside from the Tito fight, you look at his losses. He lost to John Jones. All right. Who hasn't lost to John Jones? So he's got some decent losses, but that loss to Tito Ortiz stands out. Against Teixeira, he got careless. He didn't go for any takedowns. He gets into a slugfest with Teixeira, the one thing that everybody knew he shouldn't do. So you never really know what Bader's going to do when he gets in the octagon. What are your thoughts on Bader as a fighter?
Yeah, in some ways you could look at this as he's a little bit inconsistent. He wins, he loses, you expect him to do well, and then he drops one. But let's remember, those four losses are three former UFC champions and the current number one contender for the division.
Yeah.
So these are the top-level guys, and he's also defeated former champions and number one contenders.
And the Rampage Jackson win was a nice one at the time in Japan.
That's right, yeah. He beat Nogueira. So I would say the strength of schedule here is really skewed in his favor. Anthony Perosh, he's 41 years old. I think he might be the oldest guy on the roster. He's been knocked down. I will be picking Bader here. It's a lot of juice to lay for the gamblers out there. I mean, he's a very strong favorite. But he looked very good against Teixeira right up until he caught one in the chin. And I don't think that's going to happen against Perosh. That was a bit of a lightning strike. I think Bader was surprising a lot of people by winning the stand-up exchanges against someone like Glover Teixeira, who has very good hands. So I really think that Bader is going to be in a different class here. And you're right, he's always going to come in shape. And when he gets in the octagon, they may weigh in the same amount. He is going to look a lot bigger.
Yeah, and Teixeira's, man, his knees were rubbery, weren't they? Yeah, his knees were like a drunk after last call.
He got wobbled.
Yeah, sure. yet he was able to dig down deep and respond. Bader will leave himself open, though. That's the thing. I don't think it happens against Perosh as well. But as you mentioned, we're talking about, you got to lay 6-1 here. I mean, it's coming down to some spots a little bit, but we're talking, minus 600, which is incredibly high Perosh coming off the surprise win. I guess not a shock that he beat Magalhães, but in the way that he beat him. But Perosh seems to be all or nothing. I don't think Bader will really have to get into the wrestling. I wouldn't be surprised if Bader knocks him out quickly. And speaking of fights that most likely aren't going the distance, Pat Barry. And, you know, here's another instance in what? What's Pat Barry giving up here? About 5 inches and 40 pounds?
Yeah, he gives up size in every heavyweight fight he's ever fought. So that's no different. I think the grappling threat is a problem for him because Paleli does have some interesting credentials. But Barry is a dangerous, dangerous striker. The problem is his chin. He's, you know, punch for punch, he has the worst chin rating on the entire card, this card anyway, and there's actually several scores that are quite low on this card. So, yeah, another one where if they stand and bang, it could be over very quickly. I'm not sure which way it will go, but this main card is quite loaded with potential early finishes.
Yeah, they better knock on the dressing room doors and tell everybody, be ready. Like, this is going to be one of these cards where, as you stand, all these fights, I mean, maybe a couple of them will get into the second round, and we might get one go the distance, but I'm expecting a lot of knockouts and quick stoppages on Friday night here, Saturday night in Australia. Reed Kuhn, Fightnomics.com. Check out the website. You get all the information about the upcoming book. It sounds like some great stuff and a must-have for the diehard MMA fan out there. It's always a pleasure, Reed.
Thanks so much for having me.
There's Reed Kuhn, Fightnomics.com, SureDog.com, and man, the book sounds really good. Something like you're going to want to have right beside your computer before you're clicking away when you're laying it down. Speaking of laying it down, Joey Odessa's going to join us. Going to crunch some numbers. Robin Black, we'll go 5 rounds with Black in studio here. And we got some kick-ass videos of the week, but hey, when don't we? All that and more. MMA Meltdown continues. MMA Meltdown on the Fight Network continues. I am Gabriel Morency. Thanks to Fightnomics, Reed Kuhn, for joining us. Joey Odessa will join us in a couple of moments. But not right now, we go 5 rounds with the Fight Network's Robin Black. Robin, good to have you back. How you doing?
Good, man. Doing really good.
I don't think we've had you on the show in studio since you went to Russia.
Oh, yeah, man. Yeah, that took a lot out of us. It was a great experience, you know, calling 15 different martial arts and partying with sumo wrestlers and stuff. It was a really good experience. But, man, it takes you, like, weeks to get back to normal after you spend a few weeks over.
You guys are pretty hardcore, though, because I came into the studio here, and you were here basically the next day after getting off the plane. So they're working pretty hard here, right?
Yeah,
no rest for the wicked.
Yeah, but it's a weird one. It's like you feel like you take even a couple of days off, and you feel like you lose track of kind of having your finger on everything that's going on. You know, it's like if you're obsessive enough about this game to want to do it for a living all the time, you feel like 2 days without it makes you crazy.
Well, there's a lot of stuff going on this week with the Fight Night 33 in Australia. Real quality card coming off kind of a lackluster card this past Saturday night. Although anything but lackluster when we're talking about Diaz's performance against Gray Maynard. Yeah. You know, I respect your opinions when it comes to fighters because you break it down from an analytical, technical standpoint. You told me you watch the fights in slow motion. Yeah. To get the nuances and, you know, to see the fighter's instincts and, you know, the Carlos Condit stuff was absolutely amazing.
Thanks, man.
But if you did this with Gray Maynard, there wouldn't be a whole hell of a lot because he's not really doing well. He didn't do a whole hell of a lot. You know, he didn't attempt. A lot of times, Robin, when guys start to get tagged like that, especially a wrestler, they'll sort of go into the defensive, instinctive, I'm going to put my head down and I'm going to take the guy down because I'm eating shots. Mm-hmm. Gray sort of just stood there with his hands down, like very, very strange. And Josh Koscheck, we've seen sort of fall into this trap of I'm getting hit and I'm not going to do anything about it, almost.
Yeah, it's weird. You wonder if guys are starting to just get hit harder, you know, and like Gray Maynard took, I don't know, 15 after he got rocked with that straight left hand. Maybe he was outright from that point. You know, Diaz peppered him with more, but he really didn't seem to kind of know where he was. And you kind of wonder about a guy in his 30s. He's been knocked out now 3 times in his last 4 or 5. And it's a bit spooky for guys like that. But, you know, you look at it, there's kind of precedence. The guys who kind of are on their way out, if a guy like Ray Maynard is, and there's no guarantee that he is you take a guy like Mark Hominick. We talked about that this week. Hominick lost three in a row, and he's like, I'm not ready to fully be done. I want another one. And then they gave him, like, man, I forget who it was
Eddie
now.
Hagen.
Yeah, no, Yagen, and then there was another one, that tall guy who dropped down to 135. Really, 6 foot tall dude. And he lost that one. And then he's like, okay, if I'm not beating guys at this level now, I'm going to go.
And Pablo Garza.
Pablo Garza.
Main control, Pablo Garza. It wasn't me.
Okay.
Give credit to the boys in the room.
Man, there's 500 of these guys. And you love them all. And it's exciting to analyze all of them. But it's hard to remember 500 names. We've been punched in the head a lot like I have. But, if you can't beat the Pablo Garzas, and no disrespect to him, like Mark Hominick said, but if he's not beating guys at that mid-level, he's got to go. And I suspect Maynard might do the same thing. Give me a mid-level guy, because it's hard to, these guys don't just spend their entire lifetime chasing something and then go, oh, you know, I had a bad year, I'm going to quit. They just don't do it. They just don't.
No, it's got to be a real, real, real deep, deep decision.
Yeah.
But really, Gray Maynard made $45,000.
Yeah.
So it's not like he's staying for the money, right? I mean, there's, I fear. And I wonder about a lot of these guys, what they're going to do after the fact. They didn't make the big bucks.
Yeah.
They're not going to be fighting anymore, and they're going to be 40 years old. And some of them might be a little bit punch drunk with concussion problems.
Yeah, well, like Maynard had a couple of main events, and some main events get you a little extra money, and hopefully he made that. But it's weird. We compare it to football, and we know brain injury in football is far worse, and that's an issue they're dealing with. But you're getting smashed around in the head. But the difference is, if you're making $7 million a year, it's a little easier to go, oh, man, I got hit in the head a lot in the last 5 years. I better stop. I got $35 million.
Well, that's it. They ask NFL players, are you willing to take 5 years off your life to play or 7 years, which they ultimately actually do.
Yeah.
And they say, yes, there's an acceptance to it. But there's a lot of money at stake.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a lot of money at stake. It'll be interesting to see what direction Maynard goes in from here. There was talk of him going to 145 potentially, but I don't know how much things are really going to be different for him there.
Well, the reach was an issue, and not just being on the end of the reach, but the power you generate as you close the distance with a guy with that kind of reach. So maybe that would change. You know, these guys who are dropping down a weight class, you're getting hit by smaller guys, and you're not dealing with that big reach. And there's little squat, strong wrestlers with that low center of gravity was a really great physicality 4 years ago, but now that long lean, everybody's understanding how to work that game now, so guys are getting trying to be smaller and smaller so that their reach is maximized at their weight.
Not everybody can be Cub Swanson, right?
Yeah.
And just fly in there.
Yeah, for
like,
sure.
Cub
for
doesn't, sure. He doesn't worry about reach or
anything. No. And skill trumps all. You know, it's like if you and I are the same, you've got way longer reach, or I've got way longer reach, but you're quicker and you've got skills, you'll make me pay for it. I mean, this evolution of size and body structure and height and weight and stuff happens in every sport, but Spud Webb still played basketball till late in the evolution. You know what I mean? Yeah. There's exceptions to every rule as it happens.
So this week, we've got Hunt and Silva. Some big boys throwing some heavy hands in this fight. These guys both are going to be really, really happy when they get into the octagon. And Buffer says, in the blue corner, and it's not Cain Velasquez.
Yeah.
Like if you're Silva, it's like, I'm fighting Hunt, and I'm going to Australia, but it's not Cain Velasquez.
Yeah. Yeah.
And if you're Hunt, it's like, well, I'm not going to get kicked in the head like Dos Santos did to me.
True.
They both have to think to themselves, this is going to be a little bit better, but I like Hunt in this fight.
Yeah. Let's imagine you're a heavyweight UFC fighter for a second, okay? It's bad enough that you got to go fight a 240-pound or 250-pound professional athlete, no matter who that guy is. But then there's Dos Santos and Velasquez. You're totally right. It's bad enough to fight any of these guys. Hunt, I'm starting to like, but just by going back and watching the Stefan Struve fight. You know, height and range and all that is an issue until you smash some guy's jaw, work your way in and smash his jaw. And so when you go back and
he's
you watch
willing
that
to eat
fight
them, right, too, to get in there to do it.
Yeah, and he seems to be able to take them, but you can't take him forever. If you ask me to bet, every penny in my bank account today, though, I'd go Bigfoot, I think, because I like Hunt. I do like him, but it's like size and power and I don't know. This is an interesting one. It's one that you kind of never, when you're looking at all these guys and you're imagining how skills match up, you never really kind of took the time to picture this one up until this week. You know?
Well, really, because Mark Hunt's skill never really go hand in hand.
Yeah.
He's sort of known as... Yeah.
And Bigfoot neither. You know, nobody really goes... That he's a black belt and stuff, but nobody ever really thinks of him that way. You think of him as this big mutant, you know?
Yeah, and it's funny, too, because there's guys that are bigger than him. He's actually not the biggest guy out there.
Yeah, I know. It's true.
He just looks big. His head is so big.
You know, and now you got me thinking. It's a tough one to decide to bet on because, you know, now you got Hunt at home, too. So if it's otherwise close, Hunt at home, a young guy at home is like, oh, man, you know, could go either way. Maybe the pressure's going to get too much to him. But Hunt's really experienced. This guy's been combat sporting his brains out at the highest levels all over the world. I think him being at home could be the difference in it. But I said if I was forced to bet everything I have, I'd go one way. I would just not to be forced to bet everything
you're just
I have
gonna
on
watch
this one.
This
I would just try to stay out of this
one. I'll tell you, a lot of people think this next fight is like that because even the lines makers have made it a pick'em.
Yeah.
To Kuhn and Shogun.
Yeah.
Another fight that's a pick'em. I think Shogun wins this fight.
Yeah. The reason they have him as a pick'em is because... Like Shogun versus Tahuna is a Shogun fight. And the question is he Shogun or is he like Shogun? You know, like, can he still do that? And I think Shogun, when you take a guy, he's only like 32 or 33.
32,
you
know? It's same with Vanderlei Silva. They have the appearance of being like 48.
Yeah, I know. Those guys who lived through those pride years took a whole different kind of miles on them. But I mean, you got to think that if Shogun is looking at this, he knows he can still beat this kind of guy, you know, and he's not afraid of them. And you've got to figure. And see, Tahuna is another example. I said Mark Hunt at home. At home, Australia, New Zealand,
exactly.
They would argue that. Like,
well,
they'd be like, hey, don't call me Australian.
You said that because I know an Australian, he's always like, damn, Kiwis.
Yeah, exactly.
You know?
Exactly.
Exactly.
But
it's almost like Quebec, more.
Or even Canada and the U.S. Like, if you call a Canadian American, they're not offended, but they're like, well, no, I'm Canadian.
We should note that. The Kiwis. Yeah. But it's like anything. Yeah. If it's like politics and it's like culture and life, we're not the same.
Yeah.
But when it's athletes and we're going to jump on the bandwagon because
kind of
we don't have great Australian fighters. You're Australian.
Our guy this week. So that pressure on Hunt, no pressure. But on Tahuna, that's pressure. Young guy, the whole arena's cheering for you. That, I think, that
and
extra.
And you got Shogun that's been everywhere around the world.
Yeah, exactly. So then you got a guy like that. If he is affected by that and he's trying too hard, there's that danger of the shocking destruction of Shogun in the first minute. And anything outside of that, the pressure gets to him, Shogun beats him. You figure that's kind of the scenario. Maybe he happens to land the big combination. We go, oh my God, Shogun's done. Yeah, but
I don't think it's going to happen either. And when he lost to Chael, he didn't really get beat up. He got subbed. Yeah. I don't think that's going to happen again. I said we were going to go five rounds. We only went three. We're out of time here with Robin. It's always a pleasure. Good to see you, Robin.
Thanks, man.
Always a pleasure having Robin Black in studio. Check him out right here on the Fight Network alongside John Ramdane as well. Joey Odessa will join me in a couple of minutes, but let's get to our videos of the week. And we got some crazy videos this week. We got some knockouts, we got some submissions, and we got this crazy chick that went all Mike Tyson at Oktoberfest, which I've told you guys this before. About, oh, this one's really graphic. But I never really mean it. I know they're graphic, but I never really am freaked out. A lot of times, you know, even the cameramen here are like, oh, and like, oh, that's nasty, and they're looking away and stuff. And I'm like, what's the big deal, man? So the guy's getting a metal spike taken out of his skull. Who hasn't seen that before? But I'm going to show you a video in a couple of moments that I couldn't watch. Like, I started, I was like, oh, my God. And I had to look away due to the sheer pain. Now, our videos of the week this week, let's call them a pain theme. We're the House of Pain here tonight. This dude that just got kicked in the face, did he win the fight? I guess technically he did. You tell me.
Stop! My God! Thank you.
59 seconds of the third round, we have a winner due to disqualification to an illegal kick to the head. Your winner, Mikhail Gazayev!
Man, the trainer, that's pretty ballsy. You're going to lift your fighter up after that happens? The dude was doing it the whole fight. Like, we couldn't show it. That was like the fourth round or something. We couldn't show it the whole fight. It was too long. It was like 20 minutes or whatever it was. But the guy was doing it. He was crouching and putting his hand down the whole time. And finally, he eats one. You know how many fighters in the UFC want to do that to John Jones? When Jones is just, they're just thinking, damn, they should just do it and get disqualified. Whatever. Get the shot in. get the shot in. All right, this is another great head kick. And this looks like Ben Henderson Jr. here.
What can I do?
Pretty much highlight reel type of stuff, but seems a little suspicious to me that the crowd starts screaming and then he does it. You know, talk about being the old money round there, but I thought that was a pretty good kick. Give Kendall Young some props there. Last week on the show, we had Marina Shafir on the program. She was one of the assistant coaches on Team Rousey in The Ultimate Fighter. And, you know, she's Ronda Rousey's roommate, Team Rousey and all that. And she's fighting in Tough Enough as she goes through the amateur ranks. She's about a year away from the professional ranks. Tough Enough, yeah, fight series out of Las Vegas, Nevada. It's quality stuff, and it is a real breeding ground for the UFC. We have the opportunity to show you Marina's fight from this past Friday night because it didn't last that long.
You know, if she had a baseball in her hand, I think she would have thrown a 90-mile-an-hour fastball right there.
Big right hands inside as Shafir tries to take control of the clinch.
There's that judo stuff we were talking about last week, though. Look how strong she is on her legs.
Looking to get this fight to the ground, I imagine.
So it's a good spot for her right now, you know, especially with her background. She should be able to get this to the ground fairly quickly here.
See Patterson trying to work in that crossface and keep distance.
Nice bounce there by Patterson.
Fear going to work against the fence. Could set up the standing arm triangle. There it is, right there.
Nice.
Patterson in a lot of trouble here. Looks like Shafir wants to get the choke and set it up even deeper on the ground. This fight is going to be over very soon.
This
fight is in tight, and she is out. Fight over. Marina Shafir with the submission win.
Well, Marina Shafir, now the Tough Enough champion, but pretty impressive submission skills. You can tell, man, like she's very, very strong. And congratulations to her. She was on the show with us last week. You can check it out on YouTube if you missed the episode. All right. This video here, pretty crazy stuff. This is from Oktoberfest in Australia. We're teeing up UFC Fight Night 33 here. This is Oktoberfest in Australia, and check this girl out. Forget about Marina Shafir. She pulls a Mike Tyson. She bites the guy's lip off, man. She locks in, man. She locks in. See, we got the guys on the other side of the cameras. They're, I told you, that's like the... Like, what can you do, too? She's freaking locked in. That's like worse than Tyson. That's worse than Tyson, like biting Holyfield. I'd rather get my ear bit off a little bit than some crazy Australian drunk chick clamping down like that. And Buddy was an idiot. Like, I think he thought he was going to make out with her or something. Ah, oh, she's just crazy. Yeah, she's crazy, all right. That's real crazy. And we played a lot of graphic stuff. To me, that looks like the most painful thing. I'd rather get kicked in the face by that Russian guy than get bit in the mouth by that Aussie chick. But hey, that's just me. I told you the videos were crazy. Joey Odessa coming up next. MMA Meltdown continues on the Fight Network. I am Gabriel Morency. Let's set it to Costa Rica. Joey Odessa, the premier combat sport odds maker in the business, bar freaking none, steps up and in and joins us. Joey, it's always a pleasure. How you doing?
Hey, what's happening tonight, G?
It's good to have you on the TV show. Joey, we missed you on the radio last week. Another power outage in Costa Rica, huh?
Yeah, it happened. It was actually just one in Venezuela, but the whole country went out in Venezuela, so we're doing all right.
Well, the Venezuelan vixen gets it done at the Ultimate Fighter this past Saturday night. Juliana Pena wins the Ultimate Fighter female division and basically calls Ronda Rousey out after the fact and says, what's your problem, Ronda, anyways? Chris Holdsworth, successful, kind of goes as expected. I know you liked Diaz in this fight against Maynard, but I got to be honest here, and this is where being friends with fighters puts you in a tough spot, in which I was very concerned for Gray in this fight, but I thought he could win. You know, Diaz was coming off a vicious loss against Thompson, in which, you know, I was never seen Diaz get beat up like that, even against Rory McDonald. He got slammed a couple of times, but he didn't get mauled like he did against Thompson. But we talk about fighters, and you talked about it with Gray, that those wars with Edgar just drained him. Then he gets knocked out by TJ Grant. You got to wonder what he has left right now. He only made $45,000. He's 34 years old. You got to wonder where his head is at right now. But if there's a guy that can bounce back after getting his ass kicked, it's clearly Diaz, isn't it? Nate Diaz, it doesn't matter. The guy's from the street. Doesn't bother him that he lost his last fight. He wins this fight, and he says, I'm the best fighter in the world, me and Gil.
Yeah, well, him and Gil, he brought them both out there. I tell you what, you just don't know how a guy's going to react after a knockout. And, you know, both those guys, I mean, Diaz took a heck of a beating. But, you know, I it was a tough fight to call. You really didn't know what to expect. I couldn't blame somebody for betting either side based on both of those guys' last performances and the wars that Maynard was in. I mean, Thompson looked phenomenal out there against Diaz. But, you know, that's all rearview mirror. I mean, Penny calling out Ronda Rousey was just, she has to do what's good for her career, and I guess that's a stepping stone. She got some press. We're talking about her. We probably wouldn't be otherwise. The same with the winner of the competition, Holdsworth. I mean, I guess we probably wouldn't be speaking too much about, or was it Holdsworth? See, there you go.
Yeah, it was Holdsworth. Yeah,
Joey,
all we need to know. You know, I was on Twitter Saturday night, and I saw people, like, really just dying during this card. Like, it was painful, almost. And, you know, I had guys telling me, you know what, I'm going to scrub my bathroom floor right now. I can't take this. Like, it was just too much. And the card was, like, 5 hours. The press conference after was 13 minutes. Like, the press conference, literally, it was 13 minutes. It was like, everybody, congratulations on winning the Ultimate Fighter. Okay, yeah, we're gone. We're out of here. You know, it was late even in Vegas by that time, Joey.
I tell you, they had the end show, I didn't care for it. It had like a Survivor CBS kind of feel to it, where they talked about the house and stuff. And you know what? I don't think that's the way to go. Maybe it is. I'm not a TV guy, but like, I had zero interest. It took the, you know, I don't watch the episodes, and we all know that I watch the fights. But it took, I don't know, it took a little bit of the fight out of it.
Well, the episodes this year, Joey, were actually pretty entertaining. Yet, I thought the Ultimate Fighter finale at the end of it all, they should have had some more brand name fighters on. You know, when you're putting these Ultimate Fighter contestants on, it's sloppy fighting, man. You know, they're inexperienced, it's sloppy, they're under a ton of pressure, they just want to win. You got to mix in more name fighters, former Ultimate Fighter guys. But it is what it is. Let's get to the fight night this week, Joey. This card's going to be a hell of a lot more explosive at the top here. Main event with Hunt and Silva. And you know, I look at this fight, and we're talking about it. We had Reed Kuhn on, and the guys here at the fight now, we're talking about it. And the way I look at this fight, I can't imagine. It could happen, but I think Mark Hunt knocks out Bigfoot Silva easier than Silva knocks out Hunt. It takes a hell of a lot to knock out Mark Hunt. And Silva's not Junior Dos Santos, and Mark Hunt isn't Alistair Overeem. The guy's chin is like a bank vault. I don't think Silva knocks him out, but I think Hunt knocks Silva out.
You know, it's crazy. I think the only way Silva will win this fight is if he subs Mark Hunt. I absolutely don't see him knocking him out. I could see him getting knocked out, but I think he's going to have to go for a sub. And when's the last time Silva subbed somebody? God, he always wins it by KO. I mean, and whenever he loses, I mean, he's only got one decision loss, which kind of made him, I think, gave him a little boost to his career. And that was against Werdum in Strikeforce. And, you know, a debatable decision. If I recall correctly, it was a close decision. He went on a little bit of a run. He lost to Cormier, Kane, and three upset Overeem. But at the same time, he was getting his butt kicked against Overeem before, you know, before that happened.
He was. I was on Overeem,
unfortunately.
Everything
else. I like Hunt here. You know, I think that he wins the fight. It's, you know, and so was the favorite. Surprisingly.
Yeah, you know, I like Hunt. I'll take a piece of Mark Hunt in this fight. Shogun and we got Shogun and Tahuna, basically a pick'em in this fight, Joey. I'm leaning with Shogun here. We had Reed on earlier. Reed was talking about, you know, the deep waters cliche, so to speak, the strength of opponents over the years. Shogun has been in a ton of wars, but I still think he has some gas left in the tank, and I think he has enough gas to beat Tahuna.
You know, I think if he doesn't do it early, I think he could run into some problems. But, you know, this is another bout where a guy's got a lot of miles on him against the guy Tahuna, who isn't a bad fighter, you know, who is on the road. He's used to being on the road. But, you know, it's a tough fight to bet on. Gun to my head, I like Tahuna.
Really, huh? The gun to head
pick,
he said Tahuna.
Yeah, I mean, it's tough. I mean, you look at it, and I tell you what, I think Tahuna belongs about $1.25 favorite, maybe, you know, close to a pick'em.
Yeah, I would. I'm not the odds maker. You are. So I'm surprised because of the brand name of Shogun that he's not a bigger favorite, actually.
You would think he would be. But, you know, again, now you have all those different bet markets. I mean, this is global. People don't understand. They look at one or two sports books.
Yeah.
And they don't. They think that, you know, there's only one. There's 1,000 sports books in Costa Rica. They're all over the world.
And this card, too, Joey, this is a pretty global card, right? We got Australians. It's in Australia. We got Kiwis, New Zealand. You know, there's the oceanic part of the world. They're going to be clicking a lot on Saturday, man.
And they bet.
I know they bet. You're damn right they bet.
What do they call them over there, punters?
Punters, yeah, they're punters.
Yeah, they do bet. I mean, people don't understand the whole market philosophy. I learn every day from it.
Well, I bet Aussie rules football, Joey, right? I bet the Aussie rules football, and I bet the rugby leagues over there. And it's massive, the betting. The basketball league, the NBL, the National Basketball League of Australia, they bet. And it's one of the it's kind of like Europe where, you know, they got the sports books advertising at the arenas and stuff. Like, it's legal there.
Same with the boxing, the European boxing, you know. It really, you know, I tweet every week. It just burns me up inside when these guys are quitting on the stool between rounds and stuff. Big debate for open scoring and Fight Network.
Speaking of Australia, Joey, well, right, Mosley, right? Are we going to have some funny business in Australia with the MMA like there is in boxing?
No, MMA cannot afford to have that kind of nonsense going in plain sight. Criminal. I mean, it's just not happening. You could misjudge cards. You could be a donkey, you know, a donkey judge. But
no, but you're right. Like when
Australia seems to have a license to be criminal at times, but it's not going to happen with the MMA.
You're right, though. Like with boxing, they know no shame. If the money round is the eighth. And it's 8.5, they'll have no shame. Like, the ref will call it, stop the fight, right after it goes over or right before it's going to go over. You don't really see that. You'll see bad decisions in MMA, but you know, they're not screwing around mid-round and like, oh, what a coincidence that the total, that was the exact total, and they stopped the fight, or the guy didn't get off the stool at that exact moment. Not quite the same. Ryan Bader, big favorite here. I like Bader, but I'm not in a hurry to lay 500 or 600 to do it.
Yeah, he's a big favorite. 5-6-1 favorite against a guy who's shown up. I mean, he lost to GMO, a Canadian. You know, big puncher, went out there and you know, he's got a heavy hand. Bader's been people for it by heavy-handed people. I don't know. Bader wins the fight, but five to one's too much for me. But just taking one step backwards, and I'm not a name dropper, but there's a reason why people like Adonis Stevenson last week and other people start following people on Twitter during the week of the fight. Don't think these guys don't know what the money rounds are. Don't think most of these guys don't know what the odds on these fights are. They all do, especially the boxers.
especially the boxers. I like that. Speaking of liking it, your favorite fighter, heavyweight fighter, Pat Barry, throwing it down, Joe. And I say this fictitiously, but you say what you will about Pat Barry, Joe. He's always entertaining.
I gotta like the Hulk here. I gotta like Sal, only because of, well, because he can beat the wrestlers. You know what I mean? He can beat the guys on the ground, and if he doesn't get knocked out, he's been in with way bigger guys. Yeah, I like him. I think Pat Barry's gonna have to knock him out to beat him. He's not gonna sub him.
You want more Odessa? Tune in to SiriusXM channel 167 Tuesday nights at 10 o'clock Eastern. It's MMA Meltdown Radio. Joey joins me, and we break down all the prelim fights as well. And at 9 o'clock, for all you boxing fans, Corey Erdman's talking boxing for an hour. Great stuff. He's got great guests on the show, presented by the Fight Network. Always a pleasure, Joey.
My pleasure. Just win, Gabe.
There's Joey Odessa with us. Great stuff with Joey Odessa. We'll come back and wrap things up. MMA Meltdown on the Fight Network. A great program this evening. I hope you guys enjoy watching it as much as I enjoyed hosting it tonight. Thanks to all of our guests, Reed Kuhn, Robin Black, Joey Odessa. Follow them all on Twitter. You can get my final UFC Fight Night picks, sportsragetv.com. I post all my picks on a daily basis, and I will be in Montreal this Friday night, Trophy Sports Bar, watching the fights and doing a live podcast after the fight. So come down and see us if you're in the Montreal area. Shout out to everyone here at the Fight Network. Excellent job this week, as always. We'll see you guys next week. Other than that, you're on your own. Later.